try and see how you can, you know, communicate data. So let's start with that. Why don't you, the few of you said that you have identified problems and spoken with someone, right? So I will not go out with any of them. You come, you want, like, you know, why don't three of you said, four of you said you have done, right? Why don't you share your experiences? How, like, what was the problem? What solution you got? If the talk helped, who did you speak to? How many people did you speak to? So that we can get a sense of what kind of actual communication is going on. Okay. Who's that?
So, I head the West Bengal chapter, and it runs out of NUJS. And Manohar there is in the Northeast, which runs out of NUJS itself. So, we have had conversations on various subjects, which whenever the common topic was NUJS. And mostly, we had a session just between me and Manohar, when before they left for their Northeast sensitization, where we had discussed how, because at that point of time, overall we were looking at what other activities or ways in which we could make our sensitizations more effective.
Okay.
So that was something we tried and brainstormed, and that was when we sort of came up with an idea of a skit which could be used as an icebreaker of some sort. So yeah, that's one instance during which it had happened. Also, at times during the training and coordination, since the students of both chapters would be trained in NUJS. During times we actually call up each other and
so that is because of an operational need. I'm talking about you, for example, reaching out to the, say, Rajasthan chapter, right? And sharing, because you have a lot of operational experiences, right? Have you ever tried? Because that's how our organization goes forward, right? So my question is this, that you come up with a really nice kit or a really nice you guys function like silos. You know what is a silo? Okay, you are Hyderabad chapter, that's it. I know about Hyderabad. Do you know what is going on in Rajasthan?
Yeah.
Do you think you can contribute?
I just spoke it first.
That's all I'm talking about.
Yeah. I know the example which happened. Shreyashi is a part of the West Bengal chapter, and she always sends mentorship reports across. She sends mentorship reports across to Deepthi. And once such reports Deepthi really liked, so she shared it with the entire team leaders group, saying that this is the report which we are looking for, this is what you need to follow. I'm not a part of mentorship, I don't see what is going on, but I read the report and understood, okay, these are the points you're looking for. So if I expect the report from one of my team members, then I forward it to their group also. I said, see, this is what I would want. You identify the problem and you see how to solve it. Or you, I just don't want statistics or saying
okay, stop. It doesn't matter. So I'm going to steal you something. Okay. I wanted to start with this example of communication. It's just one attribute of leadership. Okay? Just wanted to start with it to see you guys talking about this, right? And what's happening now, you see, is that you guys are telling me why things don't work. Okay? Why it's not possible. Right? Now, that's okay. So we are going somewhere because we are identifying, we are actually being ourselves and kind of starting to look at things from around. Now let us see from a leadership perspective, right? You guys tell me something, okay? How do you learn anything? You want to learn something, right? A new skill. Leadership is a skill, right? Or it's a attribute. How it's a quality, right? Some qualities can be learned. Leadership can be learned. You believe leadership can be learned? All of you believe? Anyone has a doubt that leadership can be learned? Anyone, you think you are the best leader, you have already become the best leader you can ever become? Anyone? So, we have a lot of work to do, right? So do I, you also have to. How do you learn things? Skills?
Trial
and error is the best method. Okay. So what are the other ways?
Reaching out for suggestions from others.
Reaching out to others and asking for suggestions. Okay. Any other ways? Anyone else in the room, please feel free to participate.
Getting feedback from people who are supposed to
read as well as from the scholars. Reflecting upon whatever is the value, which needs to be validated, if anyone may work for it. Yeah, something
like
to
try and analyze why it went wrong and how
you
could have probably done it better.
Is there any other good models of learning that you follow? Anyone disagrees with these models of learning? Does anyone think it doesn't work? All the models are just right. Basically, we have got three things, right? What is that include trial and error? Everyone basically says, let's do trial and error. We'll try and learn by from our mistakes, right? That's all. Is there anything else? Is there any other
model? We can learn. Trial and error is not always the best method. We can learn.
Right. Yes. No, we come to that. The other model we have heard is that you reach out to other people and learn from them. Even I say mythology, right? And our current times. So the first model I will talk about is of Krishna. Do you think Krishna was a leader? Who thinks Krishna was a leader? Who thinks Krishna? Anyone else? Any thoughts on this?
Yeah, I think
you were. How about you? Do you have any thoughts on this? Was Krishna a leader? You don't think so? Okay, why not? So, okay, you think that Krishna was not a leader. Fine. Anyone else? Anyone else has a thought on this? What about you guys?
He was a politician.
He has to be a leader. Because other than that, he cannot, you know, tell people that you do this, you will see for your good.
Now we are getting
something. I think he presented his ideas in a very, constructed way, so that you know he got a lot of people. Basically, he was a very big
politician.
So he got people on his side,
but
by
he kind of led people by exactly not imposing himself upon them, by ensuring they did what he wanted by using other means.
Yeah,
so in popular culture, there are a lot of characters who are modeled after Krishna. Okay? Many stories, especially coming out from India. Yeah.
I don't think he was a leader because he told that don't do what I do, just follow what I am saying. So it cannot be, you know, leadership quality.
Don't ask me why.
So see now this is a very deep and very interesting model of leadership of Krishna, and we'll talk a little about it. And you guys think and tell me a few. I'll ask a few questions, so I want you to pay attention. Krishna was actually the sort of leader who will actually make, he didn't do a whole lot of things himself, right? The most important thing is events of Mahabharata he has influenced at different points of time. And not only that, we all actually know, we are very familiar with the story of Krishna. And I will just tell you about popular culture, right? If you look at popular culture, how many of you watched Rajniti over here? Was there a Krishna character?
Yeah.
Who was it? What was it doing?
Yeah. It was sort of like a behind the scenes orchestrator.
Behind the scenes orchestrator.
You mean
like
Narada? No, not really. Narada Muni? Okay. Now, is Narada Muni another model you can talk about? Okay, so the way we see, it doesn't matter. We don't know these people really, right? What we are talking about is that our ideas of these people, our popular perception of these people. So if Narad Muni obviously was a catalyst in many events, okay, but was he a leader? Do you think he was a leader?
No.
He was a catalyst. Now, I am not saying a catalyst is less important than a leader. In many situations, catalysts are very important, and as leaders, we have to understand catalysts. But I am talking about, let's come back to the model of Krishna's leadership, right? So, Krishna was the greatest mentor of all time. His leadership style was of a mentor. What does a mentor do? Can you guys tell me what can a mentor do?
Direct.
He says that go and do this.
No, but he is giving instructions in that manner.
Give the instruction also.
He
give advice. What kind of advice?
From the experience.
Say, okay, I have done this before and this is my experience. Therefore, you should do this. That's what you're talking about. Anyone else?
In the right direction. Or if you want a particular example, then say, how to deal with a teacher.
Okay, how that teacher might give you
knowledge.
Strategizing. That's what you're talking about. So, okay, one attitude you know is strategizing. But Krishna was a great strategist.
Yes.
He was a great mentor. What else? Anything else?
I think a mentor should be more of a sound model. Basically, someone with whom you could actually go and discuss anything and everything under the sun.
A friend. Krishna is a sakha. Who is sakha? A friend. A friend with whom you can connect with whom you can talk to. He's supposed to be the God, right? But is he imposing his godliness on people? Someone said that, you know, he said that you do this. But at what stage did he go and who did he tell that, you know, you do this, I'm telling you, trust me. Who did you tell that? To Arjun. Okay? And did he say just that? He said that I am God. Look. And he gave proof. He demonstrated that I am God. Okay? Now it's not about religious belief. Okay, I'm an atheist myself. But I'm saying that let's look at the story. Yeah? So we have a few attributes of Krishna. He's a mentor, he is a friend, he is a strategist, and he is anything else?
He's a counsel.
Right. So friend, counsel, we're getting like, you know, we are getting a driver of this person. And anything else? He demonstrates. He's a demonstrator. Okay? He doesn't only tell you go and do this. He doesn't just impose. He is the king himself. He is the leader of the others. But he does not impose his powers on people. Rather, he counseled them. Right? So, one of the, probably Krishna as a character is so strong is because of these attributes. Because we have enough number of tyrannical kings in our mythology, right? In Mahabharata. But do you think anyone stands up as much as Krishna? Anyone is as much, you know, endeared, you know, as much loved as Krishna, has taken as much, you know, important role in the whole Mahabharata? Everyone has their role to play. But when it comes to leadership, okay, moving things along, going towards a direction, Krishna has played a very, very important role. So we can actually look into his model of leadership and learn a few things, right? So a couple of you told me earlier that you thought that he's a leader already, when I just said it. Most of the people didn't agree at that time. But two of you said that, yeah, he was a leader. Can you give me some examples? Yeah. Any story?
Arjun hesitated to fight the war in the final stage. Krishna was the one who said, he said that Bhagavad Gita, and he told, yeah, I know that you're fighting against your entire belief, I know you're fighting against your entire concept, I know you're fighting against your own family, but this is what you need to do as your Kshatriya, that's what your karma is, and the power in Bhagavad Gita.
So is that a leader going on and on and on?
No, but then he essentially made Arjun understand what he was standing for and how if he withdrew from what he was doing, the entire concept would have fallen down. He made Arjun
so he was a mentor, friend, and strategist, and demonstrator, okay, and
a good
tactician.
Operator. Not a leader.
I think I can give a better example wherein Krishna, when Yudhishthira was planning to do the Rajasabha Yagya, so at that point of time, Jarasandha was the most fearful opponent he had. And so Krishna plotted a seemingly impossible thing of getting the victory over Jarasandha, and he took two Bhim and Arjun and managed to get into Magadha, managed to make a strategy of drawing Jarasandha out in the open. And as it is seemingly possible, task of killing and killing all the 100 kings was it. That,
correct. So, see, this one story actually tells us how important is that we alone probably are nothing, right? When we stand for a cause, we connect with other people, when we involve other people in our cause, then we are powerful. Then we can actually change, you know, history, we can make things happen, right? So that's probably something you need to think. You want to be a leader, obviously. You cannot be a leader without support. But it does not always mean that I am the boss. I have got this going, right? I have power. And you do what I tell. Because people often confuse leadership with this. And it's not. Right? So our biggest learning from the Krishna story is this, that you can be a leader, almost invisible. Behind the scene orchestrator, someone said, right? I can be a friend, I can be a counsel, and that is a very, very powerful model of leadership that we can perhaps take. I'm going to shift gear. Okay, so we have spoken about Krishna enough. We have identified a few important attributes of Krishna. How many of you are writing down some of these attributes? I would have liked to write it down here on the board, but we don't have one. So why don't you write it down yourselves? Because we will work with this later. Okay. So let's look at another model of leadership from history. That is that we all know about, right? So we have Sri Krishna. It's probably a polar opposite leadership structure. We'll talk about Hitler. Was Hitler a leader?
Yes.
Right? He was the leader of half the world, so to speak. In a way, right? He drove his whole countrymen, right, towards almost like destruction, right? And did incredibly things that look very crazy right now, but at that time, an entire nation full of people found it acceptable.
He inspired people.
So we will not look at what the bad stuff he did. We have a very simple vision. We are not. Leadership is like anything at school, right? Like science, atomic energy. It's like it's there. It's not good or bad. What usually put to is a different thing. Okay. But we can take some very powerful lessons from what Hitler did, okay, and his model of leadership. Okay? And just like Krishna, in this story, you guys also know like I, right? So why don't some of you give me some examples of what do you think is Hitler's leadership point?
I was watching a video on Hitler. Okay, so initially what we used to do to influence people, he used to scare them first, after that he used to sympathize. What would happen is that in that the entire German nation will follow. Now, I don't know how you include this in.
So, if I scare people and then I make them happy, they will join me.
No, that is one of the ways you scare them. Okay, because fear, then you know, what will happen is they will have emotion. They will not follow the reason.
That's the word, emotion.
Yes. They will not follow the reason.
There, right. Okay, so that's the most important lesson from Hitler's model of leadership, engage emotions. And this is not just about being a leader, this is as effective in anything you do in your life. Okay? Always engage emotions. A lot of people think that public speaking is about some kind of talking some wisdom, some interesting things. No. Okay, the best speakers always engage people's emotions. You want to persuade people? It's a baseline. Engage people on an emotional level. You want to be a good communicator? Engage people's emotions. You want to be sensitization programs you go for, right? You want to be very good at it. You go and do it every day. Every time you go, what do? You are trying to engage the emotions. Okay? If you are a master of emotions, then it's like a very, very strong suit for a leader. So, just tell me something. How do you think Hitler engaged other people's emotions? And what is so special about? Can I have some water for you? What is so special about his leader of, a model of leadership? Any ideas? Anyone?
I can make a
United. Think. I want you to think. I don't want you to just speak from your knowledge. I want you to think that, okay? What did he do that he got an entire country full of people do things that their whole country now thinks was terrible things to do, right? Now Germany doesn't think that those are good things to do, including killing people. They did insanely unacceptable things like genocides, right? These are all like totally unacceptable. Even they think that how can we prevent this from repeating, right? But there was one leader who caused all of this. Who actually got he got popular support to do this, right? So what is it? What is there? What is the secret ingredient in this?
Nationalism. He called for nationalism.
He showed that there's a threat to you people because
we
exist.
He got the common voice.
essentially he got in United for a common cause. Some of the cause was obviously because of circumstances, but some of the causes he manipulated to bring them under the common umbrella.
Not very unlike
our
emotions. Who's
the
weaker
emotions? Who's
he engaged emotions. That part we got. What else? Is there anything else? Yes.
I think he put all his energies into making people think about their basic fear, which is a survival instinct. So either you live or they live. And that state he got them on board with his dream.
Yeah. So instincts are like another level up from emotion, right? Instinct is where you don't even have to think. Okay, so yes, he probably somewhere laid our natural instinct somewhere he laid us off, right? But what else is there? Like, you know, are there any other things we can take from his model of leadership? Anyone? Can you think of something? We know he was a powerful orator, right? What was his style of speaking? Have you ever heard? Who has internet here? Can you open like a Hitler speech from YouTube? You'll find plenty. Just find it. Anyone have?
Not
do you guys want to hear a speech? Anyone who has internet? You have to meet. So we'll see when it comes. But can we connect you to the
movie
in
German? No, there's a movie, right?
Yeah. We want to hear a real German speech.
Yeah, so there is the English movie which
I
had, what's his name?
I have to take.
You can beam it there. Plug it in beam.
Yeah, we can. Can it?
Yeah.
It won't plug in my laptop.
Why won't it plug
in? You will not.
I have a different connection.
Can you bring it there?
Bring your laptop there.
I can bring my laptop.
Do you want me to read out the speech or something?
No.
I want to hear it. See. See also if possible.
Oh, okay.
I mean, you're taking your reputation as Hitler too much.
So do you want to play it from the
is the subtitle one or is it? Yeah, subtitle. So, I think this is my mind where we got to get.
This is the
charger.
For us, all of these speeches will sound more or less the same. Except for you can hear his tone and the emotions that are coming out of this speech. So, I'm not very picky about any particular speech, anything.
And it'll be nice to see the crowd.
Yes, absolutely.
The Olympic speech that he
will do.
Olympic speech. That's a good
one. Olympic speech there, and you can see the crowd. Right? Mm, the tears in their eyes and swelling up.
See if you can find out. So let them find it in the UI you want to do, right? So, one part of was the oratory, obviously very important part of it. So that was his communication tool, right? You need to reach out to people. Okay? But what else can be done? Quick, we're getting too slow here. Come on, give me some ideas. You know our regular stories. We want people's stories, right? What else? If you see the limited world is believed, right? You do not want a leader who doesn't know what he wants or where to go. We are all somewhere do not know, we love to be led when we do not know what to do, and we always, there is some instinct in us which actually makes us feel that we do not know where we are going. Where are we heading? Right? There are some people who in the face of tremendous uncertainty can lead people because they know where they want to go. And they have a fierce belief, right? So your belief system is a very core part of your leadership, right? When if you need water from your neighbor, right, you go and ask them, how will they react? Can I have someone like this? So why don't you come? for everyone to come. And who else? Who wants to go? All these exercise? Anyone else? Please, hands up. Quick. I thought your leader said, oh, he got it. He has already participated. Who didn't participate? What did you do? You also participated. Who didn't participate? You. Okay. So, Varun, you go and see what you do.
Oh,
Pallavi.
What?
Ask for one. Your house is on fire, I don't need more.
What is your relation to your neighbor?
Doesn't matter. Your house is on fire. How does it matter who I am?
It matters, no, because then I can threaten you.
I am your enemy. Ask.
I will not ask water from
you. You will. If your house is on fire, you will. That's the whole point.
Please die. We need to die for your for principles. What can you
say? Please give me water. Please. अगर आप इस बार मुझे पानी दे देंगे तो अगली बार मैं जरूर आपकी किसी में किसी चीज में काम आऊंगी. प्लीज मुझे पानी दे दीजिए. मेरे बच्चों को मुझे बचाना है. प्लीज प्लीज मैं आपके हाथ जोड़ती हूँ. मुझे पानी चाहिए. पानी.
Okay.
I'll tell you that
okay. Showing will not do it. Okay. Yeah. What about you?
Showing.
Give it a shot. Come on, come on. Your house is on fire. There's no time. Come on, fast, quick, quick, quick.
Please give me water, please.
Okay.
You have a
light,
Nehar.
Come on. Fire, fire, come on. You need water from me, I'm not giving. Ask me.
Ramanuj, the beginning is here.
Please give me water, water, my house is on fire, please.
Okay, quick, quick, please.
I think you've covered everything.
No, go ahead, go ahead. Ask, water.
My house is on fire. Water, water, lots of water.
You got it right. Very simple, okay? If your house is on fire and your neighbor is not giving water, how do you ask the thing? Do you have any doubt? Do you have any doubt about it, Sri? When you go, do you ask him politely? Do you hesitate that he's my enemy or he's not friendly with me? He ruined my birthday party. You don't bother, right? Okay? So when you actually stand for a cause, then you should be like this. Okay, your house is on fire. And you are going because your house is on fire, you have to save your house. And that's why you are there. You don't care if they are going to say no. You are going to try your best to get it. Okay? How many of you actually do things with this kind of intensity? Okay? When you have nature's call, right? Can I stop you from here? If I am having the most important meeting here, will I be able to stop you from going? No one can stop. Not possible. Okay?
If someone stops,
it's just not gonna happen, right? Okay, so actually when you actually believe in a cause, it's somewhat like that. You can't stop. You have to do it, right? You have to do it. If you don't do it, you will not be at peace. Right? So, if you are a leader, a lot of the strength of your leadership comes from your cause. And not just from the nature of the cause, okay, I'll save the environment, but from how intense you feel about it, how passionate you are. And when you go and talk to people about it, are you thinking that, are you behaving as if your house is on fire? I'm not saying you panic and shout. Okay? But you demand. You don't just say, I could struggle with it. You will be like, give it, I need it. Okay? And that is what you should be when you are working for a cause like this. Your house is on fire. And do not forget this whenever you think that you are slacking. Okay? Whenever you think that people are not listening to you. Okay? Tell yourself that my house is on fire. I'm gonna ask as if my house is on fire. Or I need to go to the toilet. That is the urgency. That is the intensity which you ask. Because that itself spreads. That is what makes an idea spread. That makes your leadership acceptable. When your house is on fire, you are a natural leader. Because your house is on fire. You have to save it. You do not wait around for other people. You do not ask for permission. Can I save my house? Can I douse this fire? You don't ask. That's a leader. And that's what Hitler was like. Okay, so let's say this.
Before you talk to your teams, make sure you don't go to the zoo for a long time. Take home.
Just remember the feeling. Keep it in mind. That's it. Can you have some song?
No, it's fine. Put the mic.
The mic has
it. I am sure. So see, mic is pushing it. I have to check. And so it's each one of the mic. I have to check.
Put it on. possible to increase it. Maximize it though. Full screen presence.
No, it doesn't have that.
Can we not have the subtitle? I don't care what you say. I want
to see his heart.
Okay, this whistle, okay, listen to his voice, don't bother about the content. Just close your eyes. I want you guys to close your eyes and listen to that voice. Okay, now I want you to look at his face and do not read the subtitles. Just follow what he's doing. Does it look like his house is on fire?
It looks like he has an urgency to go to the loo, but yeah.
Okay, that is limited.
And he engaged the crowd.
Yeah.
He
Yeah, asking them questions instead. I mean, not questions, but you know, questions like this is what is it that's that is.
Is movement of hands to face.
Yeah, gestures.
Backside is clearly on fire.
Sorry?
Backside is clearly on fire.
So, what happens is that most of our communication, whatever we say through words, that is about 10-12% of the viewers or even someone listening to you or actually watching you speak, they register a lot more. About 70% is our non-verbal cues. Non-verbal cues include hand gestures, your facial expression, the voice, tone of your voice, the modulation. You like it or not, you have these things. Okay? You just want to have enough to engage your audience. If you are an effective public speaker or probably have the event, this is about leadership, right? Your calls must, and what you are talking to people about, what you are showing to people, it should permeate into your life. People should know that this guy, what he is saying is a house is actually a fire. He has a house. If he is coming and telling me my house is on fire, his house is on fire, then the house is on fire. And he needs water, right? So that comes from being so congruent. Right? You look at him, there is no contradiction in his body language with what he is saying. In his facial expression, his life, what he stands for, everything is congruent. Okay? And that's another very important thing we learn from these leadership models. His life is all about one thing. He always talks about one thing. He always strives for one thing. There are a lot of complicated things in his leadership model as well. For example, he was a dictator, right? He was a dictator. He had popular support, but he was a dictator. So, that along with that came out of operation, okay, not giving enough space to other people to voice their opinion, right? Killing any kind of dissent, right? So, that aside, what we learn from you is that a very effective model of leadership emerges from a few things. What are these things that you learn?
From him.
To recap quickly. What did you learn?
Okay, so when you work for God.
Please. If you are leader,
if they engage in people in emotions.
First thing, then.
You have to let them know that you first believe what you want them to believe. So he acted like Hitler actually wanted, he actually believed that Jews were bad.
Yeah, so no matter what you,
correct.
No matter what your cause is, what your belief is, it has to be, you have to feed your need. If you do not feel it yourself, you will not be able to
pass it
on. You won't be able to infect other people in the same fashion. And it almost works like sneezing, right? If I am passionate about something, you spend time with me, you become passionate about that too. Right? That's one human, universal truth that passion spreads. Okay, and you want to spread the idea of IDIA, then you have to be passionate about what you're doing. And no matter what you do in your life, if you want to be a leader, you should be the most passionate person in the world. That is one model of leadership. Of course, Krishna would be saying, right? He was a dispassionate leader, but mostly what we know, right? From what we see in my life. So what else? Anything else you might say a lot of other things. So, like, personal communication you learn from him, right? When he's speaking is about congruence is one part of it. Because when you want to be a leader, you want to be seen as a leader, you want to be accepted as a leader, congruence is a very important part of it. And
it's an emergency. You don't have all the time in the world to do this job.
Yes, that's a very important point. That, you know, it has to be happening now. But okay, you're not saying like that's what you achieve, and that's the next model you teach. Okay? What you are communicating to the outside world is necessarily not how you deal with things later. So we come to that in the next model, another very interesting model. But before that, let's wrap up on it. So we got what? Engaging emotions, confluence, belief system,
passion.
Which is passion, and anything else you say? Personal communication, right? You should be able to do personal communication actually. One-on-one and public communication. It's not fixed, it's known rocket, right? You can, it comes with access, you do it, start with it, it comes, right? Okay. We'll move on because we have a lot of things on agenda. So, moving on. So, the other model I have to talk to
you. Why don't we get them to one or two of them to how they would speak to their team members if they were sensitized people on idea and get them to join the team?
Yeah,
now that they've seen all this. And I think one show of someone who can give a shot. 1 to 2 minutes.
Yeah, someone wants to do it.
If you want to rally around people to join your team, you're the team leader, you want more people, and if you're addressing a body of people, communicating to them what the message of IDIA is and why working with you and under your leadership is going to be good. Come on, guys, after this entire exercise, one volunteer, please. One volunteer.
Come on, who's going to take the lead on this?
Anyone?
We've been working for team leaders since the longest time. So he should have, he or she should have. The team leader has been working for the
oldest time. Even if you recently, you know what IDIA is, you know what it is. You're a leader. We're asking you to exhibit a minimum leadership quality, at least talking to a group and getting your mobile idea.
Come on, who'll do it? Who's feeling the most passion right now? Who's feeling the most passion right now?
Come on, fire.
Okay, sir, what has to be done?
Come here. It's alcohol level.
Okay, so, we used to work for IDIA, but we are like really not working at all these days.
Yeah.
Okay? And you
want to motivate the team. No work is getting done. You're getting flat. IDIA is getting a bad name. You're not hitting scholars. You have so much of a responsibility towards the scholars you have, and you're not maintaining them. Perfect.
So no work is being done.
Your team is just not working and IDIA is getting a bad name. Scholars are not being being ignored, they're not being mentored properly. The entire thing is a shambles.
Okay, how about I take the example of Nanos?
Yeah.
Okay, so my entire team is a first year and there are people, they're not able to, you know, cope up with the work. They just sometimes avoid the work. So how can I, you know,
but stop explaining. You go up there, you can take
it.
So
okay.
Go behind. Stay back.
No bottle.
Now,
let
them go.
Start.
Okay, next day I have called for meeting. That and then
no,
not.
No,
we
will just start now.
Speech.
Assume that we know what your assumption. No.
First wait. Come on.
1 minute.
Yeah, yeah.
Let me check.
Get into the character.
Get into the character.
If you want, you can move out of the room. Come back. And I want one more person.
Let me check.
Here.
One minute.
Yeah, 1 minute, please.
One more person.
You can rehearse outside. Come back.
If you do not decide, I am going to think who is the most passionate person in the group.
Vasanthi.
You also go. Go. It's okay. Go and
if she wants to stay here, it's a
problem. No, it's okay. She will, if he actually steps out, she will feel like he will come into a character, right? Because she's doing a role play. It helps to step out and come back.
Manohar is getting
to the character.
You'll have a fire outside, yeah? Then you remove it to there. The position we won't be able to get the hall next year.
So when you come back to the room, I want you to come in the mode of a leader. Right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Because I know it
has to be. Do I have to be like...
No. Okay. One sec. Hang on.
You can be like Vasanthi.
Listen. That's like, go back to... That is one approach. To do, but the other approach is really to do it in a more mellow manner and just to convince, to persuade, to inspire. You see how Gandhiji spoke. Very mellow people, these are different styles, but make the connect with the audience. You don't need to follow the approach. There's only one approach, but follow diversity. There are some who will make the connect with them. If you do the Zoom with a lot of people, some people get turned off. Trust me. This one he was able to do because people are really insecure. They want their common cause, they want their thing, they want their art. But for a lot of others, they might think of this as being too imposing. Right? So follow a style that is appropriate to you, which you think will get you to persuade.
I have the same fact situation and no one is working. Or fact.
You can change the fact. You can come back and present the fact that you want. Your job is as a leader to convince people towards your cause, to mobilize them, to get them to work towards something. Right? In fact, we should tell, I hope he also doesn't, actually let him do the
you know, call him in also, we'll tell him that he needs not read. Because they may be under the impression that they're following the exact form.
Let him do it, we can talk about it.
Hello everyone. So I have been looking into Northeast chapter, and I have seen that a lot of people have been working really hard. But some of the people there, they have been doing really great job, but they are not up to mark. We are here. We are part of IDIA. IDIA is not something, you know, part of globalism. It is something much more than it. You know, we are going to a kid's home. We are sensitizing them. We are telling them that we are doing better, because these kids have no means to achieve, to get into globalism. If we work hard, if we put some efforts, what will happen is these people will go to law college and they will live their life. They will live their dream, and that's why we have to work hard. And that's it. I mean.
Very good. So what you need to now do is you got the passion, the content is formulated a little before, right? So you prepare the content, you know the pitch because you got the passion. Right? So you need to do that. And try and make sure you cover, you know, 5-6 key points that you communicate. Prepare this script. Good. Come on,
next question. Come on.
Hi, so when we first met in the beginning of the year, a lot of you had responded to the mails, and I got an impression that a lot of you have that emotion in you to work for it. And I don't want to speak about the consequences of not acting, because I think that has been taken care of by the directors. You know the consequences of not working hard. What I am aiming to do right now is to remind you of the purpose for which we had come together in the first place. We, as the relatively privileged class of the society, have a duty. We are not doing any kind of charity. We are not doing any kind of, we are not helping them out. We are not paying them money. It is our responsibility to inculcate the same ideas that we've learned through law school, to actually give effect to what we learn. Otherwise, it makes no sense. This whole education process, the whole amount of money that is being spent, cannot be wasted in a way that is, you know, that is going to make us gain in ways that are very different from what we had earlier on. But we're not letting those gains percolate to people who actually deserve them the most. So what I want you to do is, the intention will not do, you have to get that little effect. You need to report to me. I'm not saying it is, you know, I'm the leader, so you need to report to me, but I need to know what is going on. That is why I need you to tell me what is going on. And if you need me, I can help you. I know I'm not equipped with every kind of quality. I can learn. I can give you inputs. I can ask others. There's a huge network all over the country. There are people from various strata of the society who are in there to help. We have Professor Bashir, and it's a shame that you can't attend the conference that is held every year. Only we are privileged enough to attend that, but I'd like to share with you that there are so many huge people who are actually backing this cause, and we cannot let them down. We cannot let them down who we have taken on. It is our responsibility. They have trusted us, their parents are trusted.
Very different approach, right? Very different, slightly different than Manoj's approach. A more sort of, let's work together as a team. So that's what I said, this gives scope for, you can have your own style. And if you think you're not a powerful enough speaker, you have enough, your core team members, have somebody else write the script, not work as a team. But have someone connect to the team in regular talks like this can really help. Mobilize. As a leader, you must mobilize your crowd. So all your other problems, you know, they're not coming back, they're not doing the job, a lot of it will get solved if you keep mobilizing like this. And that's a great example Damanand showed, that Hitler was able to get everyone to work because you got people mobilized, you got them charged up, and you can get them in any format. Follow the format that suits you best, but a format that will work to mobilize them. And once you do that, once you've got that group connect, you create that group bonding, you share the same vision, you tell people, you sell the dream to them, you know that we're all working towards a common cause. Half of your implementation issues will happen.
if you do this properly. Because then they will themselves, you don't need to run after them. But if there's no connect, it's much harder for someone to do the work.
Correct. So today you start thinking as leaders, right? You're not just a team leader, you're actually a leader. You're to lead people into the cause. So that's why we're starting these models, right? So we looked at Krishna, we looked at Hitler. Now we'll look at a third one. But before that, since these two people actually made presentations, no matter what I think or Shabran sir thinks, I want you guys to say, to give some feedback.
Right.
You guys tell. What did he, what did these two guys did right? And how, what did they do wrong? If they did something wrong?
And how would you
how
do
can
it?
They improve?
How would you do it if you were?
Like if you, if they analyze there, so they get an idea. Like that comes like as a package, right? How you would do it. So you think. So on. Starting with you.
Not agree
with her, not. Do not go into the content. Okay, she persuaded, right?
Right.
The style.
But, alright, so what else I would be adding is, you know, I would point out the fact that how we work is, you know, the scholar's studies, the scholar's life basically is dependent on how we work, and, you know, it directly affects their life as well. And how we, our work, if we don't work, then you know the scholar's life gets affected, and they you know maybe their future gets.
So you're adding content, style wise, okay? Like from a point of view of a leadership, not just what content. They may have different causes, different things.
Rather, so let us do both. What the pitch will be and how the pitch will be delivered. So if they want to mobilize, what will the broad pitch be, and how will the pitch be delivered?
Fine.
Because both are important. You need to get the pitch right, and you need to get the delivery right.
Sure. I stopped her because it's not, you know, I think that you know, obviously there will be so many different situations you will face that you will have to come up with new pitches. But if you get the right, you know, you get the thrust of thinking, you get the persuasion right, then it will, every time it will be useful for you, right? Okay, so, okay, anything else you want to add? Like, anything, you said something on the content, right? You want to add something?
So three of them have the same kind of pitch, which is, this will affect the lives of our scholars in some way. Is there any other pitch that you would use to mobilize a team?
When I speak to the core team members, we normally relate to the difficulties they have faced as a student themselves. So those difficulties are brought up, and you know, we try to relate that to the scholars or the candidates who are giving that. So they're able to understand the difficulty more. It is a persuasive kind of talk. At the same time, you're talking to the emotional side of the person. That person has faced a difficulty. So a certain amount of aggressiveness is also involved. So it's a balance of both.
So one approach is as a moral imperative that we are responsible for these children. Let's group. You're also saying that you were also in similar issues when you first joined law school. Now if you take one of them, it's manifold.
Yes,
so therefore
exactly.
You can understand that they need much
so
more help.
So they need as much as help as you know, we can get to try and bring them into the lives that we lead.
Sure.
I'll first do what Shaishi said, then I'll come to what Namrata said. Finally, I'll say there's something in this for you too. You can only put this in your CV if you work hard. You can't just, as we discussed, you can't just put it in your CV and say, no, I haven't done all these things. So, I'll help you.
How would you take that further?
I'll
rather
help
than just
you
the
to
CV
achieve,
language,
I'll
how
help.
Would you refine that pitch?
I think what
how do you define this pitch? I think a bit more on that. We are on the right lines.
It's kind of keeping your word as well, because when you joined IDIA, you gave these scholars a dream that you said you would deliver to them. And now if you do not perform, it is you who are going back on your word.
Okay.
And in a way, if you are in a position in which you are in a position of influence and power over the other scholars, and they look up to you. They look up to us, all of us, and see how we conduct ourselves. And no matter what we do, even if we screw up a little bit, later on, even if they don't make it to CLAT, they will stay with those actions that we did. So from that angle, it becomes extremely important for both the team leaders as well as the team members to stick to what we gave our word when we joined IDIA.
It is again geared towards scholars, but the other one is, I want this theme of self-development also.
Right?
Because you need to make that pitch that this is going to help you improve yourself. In the problem, you have to be a professional. You're going out into the world where professionalism, you're going to be marked on that day in and day out. How professional are you? Can you deliver? Right?
and you've taken on a promise. Can you deliver on that promise? Can you be professional? Apart from the fact that you also have a moral imperative because you've taken on these children, you also need to understand and appreciate where they're coming from because you went through difficulties. All these are good pitches, but also there is something in it for you that you have taken this on. This is a way to improve yourself, to do these things in a team. Right? And what about the other pitch? What else would you use? So you'd use scholars, you'd use your improvement, you'd use the fact that if you do well in this, it will reflect well for your future because you're building up your own skills and it's going to look great on your CV because you're going to get a great certificate. Then who else? So somebody else put up their hand there and then I'll come. So no, sorry, both of them finished. You go, and then you go.
So like I can only offer my personal perspective and in Dalsal, like at least till when PG was there, we had functioned as a close family. So we tried to keep that up now also. So apart from all of this in our meetings, we ensure that we go back and have close interactions in their rooms, in other spaces with those people who volunteer for IDIA. We ensure that we build an emotional bond where we function as not professionals, but also as personal members of a close, I mean, whatever you call it, a family, a society, whatever. So there's
how do you create that? What's your pitch there? When you're talking to them, imagine you're talking to your group of people. And you want to create this bond. What are you telling them?
We give them ownership over their activities, right? And ownership not to the extent of liabilities, but also to the extent of telling them that whatever you do has its benefits not only towards the scholars, but towards yourself and towards this IDIA Hyderabad family that we have. Because
so
we
are creating a family
connect. Yeah, it's a ship.
A group.
It's,
if we do well as a family, we look good.
Yeah,
because are you going to push that one step further and say, well, you know, we want to be the best team? I don't know, I mean, is anyone going to make that pitch?
Okay.
Hey, there is so many teams working, but let's make the mark. We need to be the best team. We need to show others that we're the leaders here. Right? Because that was, again, one of the reasons we wanted a subtle amount of competition and a larger amount of cooperation between the teams. That's again part of how things function in the most optimal way. So will you make that pitch? You know, hey, you know, we need to really tell people that Nalsar will do it in a very different way. Right? And we'll do it fantastically well that others have to take our lead. Of course, why not? Why not? That's a great pitch to make to a group.
Huh? After the skills happened at Bangalore last year, so every time we've been like, so Bangalore did it, we can do it
too. Huh? No, all we can do better, we can do something else. If they did a little skit and I mean they did the drama,
yeah,
the Christy one, right? Allow the Christy and they raise money. You can do a cycling expedition. You can do a running expedition. You can do a trek, raise money, visit two schools, trek to a certain area, visit two schools, say it's a trek, raise money along the way, get more people to follow you. You know, you can all sorts of different fun things you can do, and you need to do fun activities. That's again a sign of keeping your team bonded. See, bonding is very, very essential because that actually takes care of 80% of your implementation problems. If you've got a strongly bonded team and you create activities to create that bonding, and which is why we requested Amanus to come here and do so, you can see the value of a group exercise immediately. Right? Immediately, it's not like a session where there's a top-down, somebody's talking to you and that's it. But it's more of a group exercise, we're doing an activity, we feel like we're a closely connected community. Right? We share the same goal. It's a fun activity. Try and create space for moral growth.
You can go back and do this with your
teams,
right? So make sure that in your team you create leaders, because that's very important at work. Right? You don't want to be the only leader in the organization. That's a very sad situation.
Absolutely.
I think someone had here something to say.
What I have seen was very similar to what Dipankar actually said. So when I joined IDIA, it was more like a close-in family. So essentially, when I would want to pitch it to my members, I would essentially say, y'all were chosen over the others who also applied because we build a trust in you to fulfill whatever you've chosen to do. So,
you're giving them the notion that they're the privileged ones.
Yeah,
right?
And that's privileged and a part of the family, and the families always work towards it. And if you're not, you're disappointing not only yourself, but you're disappointing all of us who put our trust in.
Will you take it one step forward and connect back to Professor Mitra's presentation in the morning where he said, what did NLS do? Right from day one, they told us you're the best. That's it. They kept drumming in. You're the best, you're the best, you're the best. You're the Harvard of the East. IDIA goes through a very rigorous selection procedure. If we picked you, you're the best. Make sure that selection procedure is rigorous. Get them to believe that. Because when somebody believes they're the best, they'll perform. Automatically. So, privilege. You're the chosen one. Now, why do the Jews do so well in life? You look at the Jews. It's the exact opposite of that. You know, so providing a counter. Contrast. Exactly what happened. The Jews, because of persecution, right? Persecution played a large role in why they bonded so well together, but there's another reason why they did so well. Why?
Commerce.
Why? Why did the Jews do so well as a community?
Because they had the same commercial interest, they stuck.
One part. That's partially correct reason.
They have been brought together as a community by outside forces, and if they were lacking an identity, others gave them that particular identity.
Part of the reason. I want the main reason. Go back in history. Where did the Jews come from?
There are all the same.
Which prophet?
Jesus.
What do they believe? The chosen one. The chosen one. That's a very, very powerful thing that you can plant into somebody's head. You're the chosen one. You have to transform society. And you're doing it at such a young age. You are transforming in a revolutionary way. You're doing what many people in the legal profession in 50 years cannot do. Why do you think these people give us their time? You think they're stupid? Are they getting money out of it? Are they getting anything out of it? Nothing. But we put their names on a board of advisors, but there are like 100 names there. It gets diluted anyway. They're doing it because they know that this is transformative. And everyone wants to be part of it. So when you're actually doing it, and you have all the outside support, there is a special privilege associated with that. You are in many ways the chosen ones. And you have to believe that.
I would like to add something to this, to what sir just said. Okay, it's not just you are chosen ones, you are great people, you are working on a great cause. But it's not just that, okay? You are a community of people. Okay, you are a community, pan-India community. Do you understand the strength of this network? Okay? All of you can help each other, not just with IDIA. You will make friends, you will stay in touch over time. And that's what we need to build here, right? So that's why you guys need to connect, right? So all of you are here today, and you are leaders, right? So you will be leading a lot of, right? Lot many great things in the future, and all of you will help each other. And this is a very important reason why others will want to join you. And you have to make it. Right now it may not seem like that. We have never pushed it like that, but it's a reality, right? Today if I reach out to all of you and say, can you help me with this? You'll say yes. Because we have worked together, we share a passion, we share a connection, right? We are part of a community.
And again, extending what Ramanuj said, increase the coolness quotient of IDIA. Put it very mildly. Right, but you get the message. Which is why Trina's proposition for an IDIA film is a great one. Because it looks cool, right? You're doing a film festival, you're doing all these cool things in your law school as part of the IDIA team. And you need that visibility within the law schools. You need people to know that this is one hell of a community. And you should be part of this. You're doing good work, you're transforming society, and you're having fun. That should be the message. We're doing meaningful work. We're making really good time. As students, we're doing things that people 10 to 50 years in the profession haven't done to be able to transform in this significant way. And we're having fun. Right? Very powerful. That's the brand. So this is all about branding also. You know, what is a brand at the end of the day? You know what a brand is? What is a brand? What is a brand? Why do you pay so much for your Nike or Adidas? What does Coke stand for? What do you think Coke stands for? Go back to Coke's advertisement. What does Coke? Give me one or two of Coke's advertisements.
Fun.
Fun? Musti? What else? Sorry?
It completes your dinner. Completes your
dinner. Think of Coke and think of all the messages they're trying to get at you through the advertising.
You should associate your happiness with the product.
Happiness! Great! Happiness! That's the latest ad, right? Coke ad. Then get it into your head that Coke is about happiness. You drink a Coke and you're just automatically happy. Right? You're elevated. And IDIA needs a kind of branding. IDIA needs a branding that says, we're transforming, we're revolutionaries, We're creating a great future for these children and for these communities, and we're having great fun.
So this
that's the kind of imagery, that's the brand. We need to build into that brand. You need a position. So a brand, a positioning comes before a brand. So we positioned ourselves, and the reason we've got us mass support is because people agree with that position. Our positioning is we're transforming society, we're revolutionizing society, we're empowering the underprivileged. That's the position we're in, right? And we're doing it all through legal education. And we're doing it through the school network of student volunteers. That's one thing that everyone finds fascinating. I mean, I've spoken to a number of NGOs around, and everyone finds it really cool that our 80%, 90% of IDIA is really run by students. And we need to leverage that. You saw, even when Moili came, they didn't want our photographs. Right? They said, step back, we don't want you. We want the students. Right? In court, Gopal Subramaniam is there agreeing to argue pro bono for us in the access to education matter, where Delhi University is being sued in a photocopying matter. And the first time we approach him, yeah, he gives me 2 minutes, because he knows me from before, speaks very politely. But the moment I throw 3 students in front of him, spends half an hour. You have to recognize your strength. People love to be associated with students. Draw on them. Because they like the passion that comes with you. They like to believe that, you know, in your company, they become normal. Right? It's why a lot of us still want to be close to law schools. Right? Say, never grow old, be close to a law school. Because you have the youthful energy, the passion, the enthusiasm. You have to build on that.
So I would like to actually connect back what you just said with something. So we discussed this today, right? You said that engage emotions, right? Counsel people, we say all of these things, right? Now, if you are going to engage someone's emotions, you have to decide what is this emotion. We have discussed on a very theoretical level. But you have to decide, like, you have, like, there has to be a collective decision on this, as what does, if folks stands for happiness, what does IDIA stand for, right? You have to find that, you have to decide that for your reason, because again, you have to believe in it to be able to do it.